I'm Angelique Trusler. I'm the regional consultant for Southern Africa at the Carpentries. And thank you so much for inviting me, the ESCALATOR team, to come and share my story with you and how I became the regional consultant of Southern Africa at the Carpentries. You know, I have crypt notes already, so that was already, well, that's fine. So I would like to tell you a story about how I got involved in an open access community called the Carpentries. Now, once upon a time, there was a girl named Angelique. I'm cute, right? I'm very witty, always have something to say if I listen to what my family members had to say. But from a very, very young age, I was really interested in how things work. I had a bucket of Legos with my cousins, the cars, how the engines worked, the remote control cars. I always wanted to see what's inside. Right, and I recall one Christmas when I begged my mom and dad to buy me a radio cassette player, and I'm giving my age away, right? Because back then CD players weren't made yet. But I really enjoyed music and I wanted to listen to the music, but I saw a program on television and I wanted to see what it looked like inside. So gratefully, I got a small radio cassette player that Christmas and I kept taking it apart and putting it back again. However, I got comments like, but girls play with Barbies and dolls and girls don't take radio cassette players apart. And I did not understand this as a very young lady. I said, but why? Why is there toys for boys and toys for girls? And none of my elders who said that could explain to me why the stereotype existed. And I was always asking how and why and when. And I grew up. And now I'm taking computer PCs apart and putting them back together. So nothing much has changed around that. However, no one's asking me, why are you a girl and the girls are doing this? So I want to share my story with you today. So to summarize, from a very young age, I've been pushing the boundaries when it comes to gender roles and gender stereotypes. Now, if we fast forward a couple of years, I got involved in educational psychology. That was my major. I'm a registered counselor, and I'm got into quantitative research. But those of you in the social sciences know that at most, we probably had an introduction to statistics module in our first year. And after that, we didn't get into depth into research stats. We didn't get into depth to programming courses in our curriculum. And for a brief period, it hindered me a lot, because I couldn't do my own statistics. I couldn't do my own research, even though I wanted still to understand how things work. And specifically in this case, how an ecology helps young people to be resilient. And I had great supporters. I had supervisors that helped me get funding to attend workshops abroad and attend workshops in South Africa. But I still found myself as one of few females in a quantitative workshop in South Africa. And that always kept me wondering, but why is this so exclusive? Why do I have to pay so much money? It's not accessible to all. It's not equitable for all to attend these workshops. And I always thought this would hinder females to become researchers, specifically in quantitative methodologies. Moving on. In my PhD, I got involved with a research focus area at the Northwest University. And as I mentioned, my supervisors, co-authors of my papers navigated me and supported me into areas where I can grow my skill set as a quantitative researcher. And Analda's nodding her head because she knows this picture quite well. And this is where I got to know Analda at the Northwest University's e-research initiative. I got invited to an initial meeting where we were all told about computational digital research and open science and data research management and funding. And that's where the bug bit me. I absolutely enjoyed this. And I knew all those questions I had about why are research skills not equitable and accessible and just, you know, right there for us to use. And this got me really into the open science, open access discipline. Moving on another year, through my involvement in the Northwest University's e-research initiative, I got to apply for funding to attend this international training workshop for developing countries in Beijing, China for 3 weeks. And this is where my mind was blown. It was hosted by the Chinese Academy of Science, and I got to see a supercomputer for the first time in my life. I went to the Chinese space station and we could see how they make use of big data and data science. And that's like, you know, an Afrikaans said, the coolest hierdie kerk, that's literally what it was. I was head over heels for data science and programming and specifically open source, because all those concerns I had for so many years, it seemed like the answer. Moving on another year, I got the opportunity to become a Carpentries badged instructor. We, a bunch of, so you can see the picture in the middle there, a bunch of South Africans got together in Cape Town under leadership of an elder and a bunch of trainers at the Carpentries. And I went through the Carpentries training curriculum and checkup process. And I could now run workshops and teach and co-teach workshops with other instructors in South Africa. Jumping another year, I saw the advertisement for a regional consultant for Southern Africa, and I thought, how great will it be if I could get paid to break down the barriers of programming and data analysis? And November 2019, I joined the team. Now I'm standing here in front of you, talking to you. But even though I had these great supports, and I had great individuals coming up, you know, over my path, helping me and guiding me towards this, the reality still sits that we face significant challenges when teaching programming and data analytics skills in Africa. Sad but true. The challenges, among others, are cultural differences, diversity in data sets. We have data sets from the global north, the digital divide, access to hardware, bandwidth, quality digital skills programs, educational inequalities. For most individuals who are lucky enough to attend university, that might be the first place where they see a computer and get to know digital skills. Language differences. Myself, I'm not a first language English speaker. So learning the data analysis in English was sometimes difficult. I had to translate back to Afrikaans. Now, what about individuals who the language they are learning might be the second, third, fourth, maybe fifth learning language? And specifically, my attention was drawn to learning difficulties. How do we adapt teaching programming in Africa to individuals who have learning difficulties? But the literature speaks about gender and programming a bit more as well. Female exclusion. Access to university as a student or as an employee is less likely for females. Accessing hardware processes that aren't gender sensitive, I can go on. What society expects of you. I read on Twitter a meme that said that no one asks my husband who looks after my children when I'm at work. While I believe 50-50 parenting, that's true. And it breaks you down a bit because you would like a career as well, but also the family life. Another piece of literature speaks to the digital divide. This ties into female exclusion between access to hardware, bandwidth, quality digital skills programs. And this is where the Carpentries in Africa come in. We aim to address the challenges I have mentioned. It's going to be a long path. It's not going to be a simple solution, but we have an organization that has come, maybe I can skip one slide quickly. There we go. Organization that has grown in Africa and are looking to grow even further, and we can address these challenges we are experiencing currently. Now at the Carpentries, we teach foundational coding and data analytics skills to researchers, students, scholars worldwide. But also we aim to establish a network for the regional Carpentries community. And that's my role in South Africa and the broader Africa. We look at a timeline. Our first workshop, Carpentries workshop, was run in 2013. We skip over to our first instructor training event in 2016, our first African Carpentries community meetup in 2017, Carpentry Connect Johannesburg 2018, amazing, 2019 regional consultant was appointed, and in 2020 we piloted online workshops because of the COVID-19 pandemic. If we look at a bit more stats, I drew for us from 2018 to date, we had a great spike in 2018 for Carpentries workshops run in Ethiopia and South Africa. And that was due to the funding that Analda had when Analda was, I can't remember the, I remember the acronym, but I can't remember the link of the funding we received. But I remember I taught a lot with Analda and other instructors in South Africa. And this is what this boom looks like here as well. You see COVID, it kind of slumped a bit, but currently we are projected to pass the 2020 workshops, not only in South Africa, but in the whole of Africa as well. You can see the small little lines here. We have a workshop currently running in Mauritius. We have workshop running in Ghana, Nigeria, Kenya, at the, well, in the next couple of weeks, and that's exciting news. Badge instructors per nationality. We, the bulk of our instructors are in South Africa. However, we're seeing up and coming communities in Kenya, Ethiopia, as well as in Nigeria. The Carpentries coordinates workshops currently online, and they spread over 5 mornings due to Zoom fatigue. However, in pre-COVID days, they were run in 3 consecutive days in person, and they could consist over 3 different projects, we call them. Software carpentry, data carpentry, and library carpentry. Where software carpentry aims researchers who need to program more effectively or would like to manipulate software. The data carpentry project looks at researchers who want to analyze their own data. And that's very discipline specific. We have programs for ecology, for genomics, social science, which I will allude to a bit in the next slide. Lastly, we have library carpentry. These programs and workshop lessons are aimed at people in the library and information related roles. So what I mentioned earlier around the discipline specific lesson, we have a data carpentry R for social science lesson that's very popular currently in South Africa, especially among the social sciences and humanities learners. Sorry, my voice is losing a bit at the moment. But what, in a nutshell, it exists of is 3 programming languages that are all open source or could be found in an open source form. The first would be a spreadsheet program where we learn how to capture data more effectively, to make clean, to work with it effectively, to validate data capturing. We would move on to OpenRefine, which is a tool that helps us filter and sort and furthermore make a deeper cleanse of our data sets. We then move one step on and learn the foundational skills around using R. So if any of you would like to host a R for social science workshop in the future, we do have funding through Sadilar to host workshops in the humanities and social sciences in Southern Africa. Please reach out to me if you think about a workshop like this next year. We are starting to fill up dates very soon. It'll be exciting to reach even more learners next year. Now, upcoming events, last week I spoke about Carpentry Connect South Africa, and the main goal of Carpentry Connect South Africa is to build capacity for workshops through instructor training and establish a network for regional carpentries communities. While the seats have been filled for all our workshops, I would love to invite you to our keynote, our networking events, as well as our closing address. It will be a great opportunity to see what we do at the Carpentries, how we work together, and grow computational skills in the continent. In the Google Doc, Analda shared, I pasted all the links for you right there so you don't have to worry about missing them somewhere. Now, how can you get involved with the Carpentries? I added a couple of links here. So we need volunteer instructors. If you think this is something you might be interested in, please reach out to me, angelique@carpentries.org. A voluntary instructor would then take part, just like what I did, in a Carpentries instructor training event and go through the checkout process, which we mentor you in. And if you don't feel comfortable in teaching Python or R, this is how I learned how to program R. And Nalda alluded to this earlier, that when I started as an instructor, the introduction parts of the lessons, that's what I would teach. But as I got more comfortable and I got to know skills and I used it in my own research, I now can teach visualization, et cetera, et cetera. So don't feel put back if you feel that this programming language might be too much at the moment, or you feel a bit overwhelmed. I use this as a tool to help myself learn programming. Next up, we have African Carpentries Monthly Meetup every fourth Thursday of the month. So next week, Thursday, we're going to host our next meeting. Again, I shared links in the Google Doc where you can find connection details, etc. I invite you to join us. Come speak to us. Come tell us what you are doing where you're based. We learn so much from each other, and we learn even in the pandemic, online teaching, sharing skills and how to deal with low bandwidth situations. How could we run Carpentries in African way? And this is a great opportunity to share your knowledge. So I mentioned institutions to host a workshop. Salilar is hosting carpentry workshops specifically for the social sciences and humanities. I invite you to reach out to me if you would like to host such a workshop at your institution next year. Now, Glossario is a passion project for me. It's an open source glossary of terms used in data science that is available online, specifically aimed at R and Python. And we are currently translating data science terms and not only Afrikaans, isiZulu, isiXhosa, Amharic, but also in Setswana. We are desperately looking for volunteer translators to help us. If this is your thing and you think this is something you would like to get involved with, email me at angelique@carpentries.org. It will be great to learn more about different languages and how we can support different language learning. And lastly, we have a mailing list if you would like to receive updates of funding opportunities, new workshops you might want to attend, networking events. Please sign up for the mailing list and you will always be connected. So lastly, I want to thank you and thank Analda for giving me the opportunity to share my story with you. I don't think this is the end of the story. I just think it's midway, halfway, you know. Maybe next year we can return and I can tell you what I've done in the last year.